Wake up, Dad!
What? I gotta teach my class!
No, Dad, it's a snow day.
What?
Snow day.
Oh. What am I gonna do? How am I gonna make up all that? That time. Time.
Well, I'm the voice. Oh dear. That's the trouble with regeneration. You never can quite be certain what you're going to get. Although I do say, I think the nose is a definite improvement. Well, enough about me. You're here to learn about the Spanish-American War. Your professor invited me to come give you this lecture, largely on account of the fact that I was there. And, of course, he and I are very close. But to do that, I first need to show you the pictures. And to do that, I need... Oh, not that kind of screwdriver. Oh, useful in a pinch, but not what I need now. Let me see. Oh, I say, I wondered where that got to. Very good. Aha! My sonic screwdriver! Let me show you the pictures. Well, to tell a story, we need setting. And to do that, I need a map. And here you can see a map of the Spanish Seaborne Empire in its prime. By the point in time we're dealing with, however, it is not in its prime. By the late 19th century, the empire is all but crumbled. It is falling apart. All that remains of the once great Spanish Empire can be found in the Caribbean or in Asia. Nothing is left on the mainland. And so today we will begin more specifically in the Caribbean, more specifically here on the island of Cuba. The day we will begin, February 15th, 1898. And on this day, as you can see here, the newspapers of the day, the New York Journal, February 15th, 1898, a terrible, terrible tragedy occurs. New York Journal and Advertiser. Destruction of the warship Maine was the work of an enemy. And to tell you that story, let us return to the library. Well, let us begin today on a rather somber note. The day, February the 15th, 1898, a day that would live in infamy in the history of the world. In the Havana Harbor, near the shore is a ship, a great battleship, the USS Maine. And on this day, February the 15th, 1898, the Maine was destroyed. And the question everyone was asking, as 250 of the men on the ship died, was this. Why did this happen? Who brought down our ship? Well, the newspapers of the day were very quick with a response. They sensationalized the story, as Americans always do. Let me take you, February 15th, 1898, to the New York Journal that I showed you before. Ah, here it is. Ah, naval men here are agreed that the explosion that wrecked the Maine was not caused by any accident on board the ship itself, but that the cause came from the outside. In other words, that the main was blown up by a torpedo or a submarine mine. Well, the United States of America quickly declared war, and within 109 days, Spain was defeated. The story of this war marks the end of the Spanish-American Empire. It marks the end of Spanish control, not only of Cuba, but also of the Philippines, of Puerto Rico as well. It also marks not just the end of the Spanish Empire, but the rise, the beginning of the rise of the United States as a world power. And in order then to understand this story, we must go back in time. Time and space. And to do that, I need my keys. I cannot find them. I will show you an image. And I promise that by the end, I will take you on a journey. Oh, what do we have here? Your list of terms. Jolly good. It goes from the Spanish-American War down the line to Jose Marti. Of course, you know, people assume that time is a strict progression of cause to effect. But actually, from a non-linear, non-subjective viewpoint, it's much more like a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff. So that being said, good luck taking your notes.
Where were we? Where was I? Oh, yes, I remember where I was. The 1830s, the 1840s, the United States, and its growing influence in the history of Cuba. Well, in the 1830s and in the 1840s, the United States increasingly was interested in actually annexing Cuba, taking it over, if you will. This is an important moment in terms of the history of U.S. manifest destiny, and you see it play out not only in Cuba, but in a larger context as well. 1830s, the 1840s, the United States is annexing other places, among others, portions of what is today Utah, New Mexico, Colorado, California. Not only that, that is the story of the Mexican-American War and the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo that I'll show you an image of in a moment. But not only that, the United States was eventually annexing Texas as well. Well, this is the context in which Southern politicians in the United States began to become interested in taking over Cuba as well. The conspirators were of all sorts, with all sorts of ideas. In terms of ideas, my favorite, Cuba, was reliant upon Spain for all sorts of things during this era. But Spanish politics were complicated. They were topsy-turvy, and the conspirators had an idea. They would give the Spanish government a loan and use Cuba as collateral. When the government, the politicians in Spain, didn't pay the loan back, they would foreclose and take over Cuba. A grand idea, but one that never met anywhere at all. Never went anywhere at all. Meanwhile, northern interests were very much against taking over in places like Cuba. And this is, of course, a study, a story, I should say, in politics of the United States of this era and sectionalism. Give you an example. In the North, we have John Hale, a senator from New Hampshire, who writes in 1859, giving reason that the United States should not annex Cuba. He writes that, quote, "To extend the boundaries of this country for the express purpose of bringing into this confederacy territories, islands, and states whose great and controlling merit is that they are slave states, slave territories, and slave islands," was not something he was willing to do. Similarly, another example, an example from Connecticut. James Dixon of Connecticut expressed similar qualms. He writes, "It is to perpetuate slavery in Cuba that the people of the North are requested now to contribute their means for this acquisition. Why should we do it? Well, you'll learn more about U.S. Manifest Destiny in the future as we move forward and look at the United States, not only in the Caribbean, but in Central America as well. For now, suffice it to say that with the coming of the U.S. Civil War, all talk of the invasion, the annexation of Caribbean islands ceases in the United States of America. That isn't to say, however, that Cuba or the United States will cut themselves off from one another. Rather, you see an increasing economic reliance upon one another in the decades ahead, in no small part because of Cuban sugar. The second half of the 19th century, Cuba would increasingly send its supplies of sugar to the United States of America. It was a question of proximity. It was a question of markets as well. Cuba, the United States, did not exist in a vacuum. Rather, during the same period, off in Europe, sugar beets were making their way in the world, and sugar beets make sugar, giving Europe another supply outside of the Caribbean entirely. Well, what is the upshot, as you Americans might say, of all of this? Well, on the one hand, Cuba would find itself in an increasingly contradictory position. Number one, it was increasingly becoming reliant upon the economy of the United States of America at the same point in time. Number two, when it was increasingly becoming and acquiring a tradition of revolutionary patriotism in terms of its relationship with Spain. Well, we shall talk about the relationship with Spain, the designs of Europe upon the Caribbean, in a moment. Before doing that, let us take a step back and review. Let me show you another picture.
Well, you see here a map of the United States, and this map gives you a sense, really, of the tremendous designs that the United States of America has upon the West at this point in time. As I said, it is a time of manifest destiny. Texas will be annexed in 1845. Large portions of modern-day Utah, Arizona, Nevada, California, New Mexico, and Colorado will be ceded to the United States as well as part of the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo that brought the Mexican-American War to an end. Yet another war, a war about manifest destiny that took place between 1846 and 1848.
Ah, yes. Now, where were we? Where are we? Ah, yes. Cuba, Spain, and the Great War for Cuban Independence. Well, not just yet, but I promise we will get there. Oh! Oh my giddy aunt! Have you ever been to Scaro? Don't recommend it. Stick to the Caribbean, and let's go there now. The relationship between Cuba and Spain. Well, as I was saying, Cuba was part of the last vestiges of what had once been the great Spanish seaborne empire. And therefore, when it becomes apparent that the United States will not step in to annex the island on account of the civil war in the United States, Cuban planters themselves become uneasy and they begin to conspire. They want greater autonomy. They want reform. Off in Madrid, however, there is no desire for reform. Cuba is the last of this empire. It is a question of honor, of pride, and Spanish politicians refuse to budge. Thereafter, you will have conflict. And just as we saw a civil war in the United States over slavery, there will be a civil war between Spain and Cuba. And that great civil war, the first of these civil wars, is the so-called 10 Years' War that goes between 1868 and 1878. Well, on October the 10th, 1868, a planter by the name of Carlos Manuel de Cespedes, a very kind gentleman, I met him once, decided to issue a call for Cuban independence. And on this day, he issues his so-called Grito de Yara, this great call for independence. Well, as I said, the war will go on for another 10 years. It's called the 10 Years' War, very creative. Well, what the dynamics of this 10 Years' War? Well, on the one hand, planters and others who want independence will free their slaves, organize armies of free slaves, of former slaves as soldiers to fight. And it brings up the fact that the ideas of independence and abolition were very much intertwined, not unlike what we previously saw in the Haitian Revolution. Well, they are intertwined, and yet the peace of 1878 will ultimately not result in abolition. White society was very much afraid of blacks, afraid more especially of the prospects of a race war. And this prevents this society from grasping what otherwise would have been theirs, independence. As one of the rebel leaders explained, when speaking to a journalist, the call, the fight for independence, was not a simple matter. As he said, among the whites, some eternally waver on account of the risks of the enterprise, and others hesitate out of fear of a servile war with the Negroes and the mulattoes if Cuba becomes free. Well, the contradictory dynamics of the war are further seen in the revolutionary attempts of the planters and others to have the slaves themselves join in the rebellion. On the one hand, early rebel leaders attempted to equate being Cuban with abolition, being free from servitude to Spain. Spain, therefore, is equated with slavery. On the other hand, the same planters make very clear distinctions between what it means to be Cuban and what it means to be black. Let me show you a handbill, an advertisement, if you will, that the planters used who sought their independence, trying to gain armies of free blacks and others to fight on their side.
And here we have the very handbill that I was referring to, an advertisement calling upon blacks, upon slaves and former slaves, to rise up in rebellion and fight for the cause of independence. Let us read. The blacks are the same as the whites. The whites are not slaves, nor do they work for the blacks. Neither should the blacks be slaves, nor should they work for the whites. The Cubans want the blacks to be free. The Spaniards want the blacks to continue being slaves. The Cubans are fighting against the Spaniards. The blacks who have any honor should go fight together with the Cubans. The Spaniards want to kill the Cubans so that the blacks can never be free. The blacks are not dumb. They have a big heart and they fight together with the Cubans. The time to fight has come. It is better to be in the woods fighting together with the Cubans so that all men, blacks as well as whites, be free than to be working as slaves. Long live liberty. Well, a call to arms, a call to union for blacks and whites to fight side by side. And yet, significantly, the title of Cuban is reserved for whites. Blacks are not welcome to carry this patriotic title. The multifaceted dynamics of Cuban independence can perhaps best be illustrated in this respect in the contradictions that we find in the lives of blacks or those of mixed race who would rise through the ranks to become important military officers in the fight for independence. To this end, let me tell you the story of this man, Antonio Maceo. Born on June 14, 1848, he was the son of a Venezuelan mulatto and an Afro-Cuban woman. He worked as a small-time farmer until 1868, when the War for Independence first began, the 10 Years' War that I've referred to before. He initially enlists in the cause as a private in 1868, but after only 5 years he will be serving as a general on account of his bravery and his strategical acumen. The initial fight for independence will of course come to an end in 1878, and yet because the treaty that ended the conflict did not result in the abolition of slavery, Maceo refused to recognize it. Instead, he will flee to New York City, from which he will launch another fight for independence in 1879 and 1880. When this was unsuccessful, he will eventually return to Cuba yet again in 1895 to fight, when Cuba once more goes to war with Spain. He will eventually be killed a year later on December 7th, 1896. In his day and time, his story embraces, it speaks to the contradictions of slavery, of abolition, and of independence, and the strange and complicated manner in which they were intertwined. Today, of course, his life is celebrated. His portrait graces the 5-peso bill in Cuban currency.
Well, between 1878 and 1895, everything in Cuba will change. And in no small part, that has to do with the coming of abolition. Abolition will not come to Cuba until 1886. And the story of how it comes, and the manner in which it has consequences thereafter, are the rub. Well, as I said, the treaty that ends the 10 Years' War in 1878 did not do away with slavery. It did not bring independence to Cuba either. However, it did free the slaves who had fought on one side or the other. You have the beginnings of abolition. 2 years later, in 1880, the Spanish courts, the Spanish Parliament, if you will, in Madrid, finally approve a law bringing slavery to an end in Cuba. The idea behind the law of 1880 is that you would have a period of manumission, that it would be gradual, that it wouldn't take place all at once, that it would take a period of 8 years to arrive at. In reality, the slaves themselves want their freedom sooner. Eventually, the crown steps in, and by royal decree, on October the 7th, 1886, ends slavery forever in Cuba. Well, the implications of this are monumental. In the coming months and years, you'll have to excuse me. In the coming months and years, the coming of abolition will usher in other political changes as well, most notably an increased willingness to embrace radical ideas like independence. In this regard, the authorities will uncover independence plots in 1880, 1884, 85, 1890, 1893, and of course, the Great War again for independence that kicks itself off again in 1895. The leaders of this warfare include Antonio Maceo, that we've already talked about, as well as Massimo Gomez and Jose Marti. Well, the war will go on for an additional 3 years. It's a bloody, bloody war. Excuse the expression. Ultimately, however, it will end in 1898 when the United States steps in on the side of the insurgents after the sinking of the Maine and enters then onto the scene to end the war. And that, my friends, takes us to where we began. The sinking of a ship off the coasts of Cuba in 1898. Well, this gives you a sense of things. It's an amazing story, the coming of independence, the end of abolition, the end of slavery, I should say, in Cuba. It's an amazing, amazing sort of story. Let me show you some images again that speak to that. And to do so, let me find it here. Get the right setting. Very good. There we are.
And here we have an image that brings us back to the moment when the Spanish-American War began, the sinking of the Maine. Here you can see the Reverend Father Chidwick, the Maine's chaplain, delivering a prayer at the burial of the Maine's victims. It's important to note here that this is what brings the United States into the war. And yet, did Spain really sink the Maine? Today, the answer is thought to be no. One day I'll have to go and check on it. Moving on. A point to make is that this is but one corner of one country and one continent on one planet that's a corner of a galaxy, that's a corner of a universe that is forever growing and shrinking and creating and destroying and never remaining the same for a single millisecond. Oh, and there is so much to see. There's so much to see. Let's go on. Here we have the first encampment, American encampment on Cuban soil. This is near Santiago, which was the first major city the Americans would take. Moving on from there, here you can see a battery of the 2nd U.S. Artillery in at Guard Mount in Havana. And moving on from there, who is this? Oh, Colonel Theodore Roosevelt, the leader of the Rough Riders. And here you can see the Rough Riders, or rather, the 1st U.S. Volunteer Cavalry. The Rough Riders, the reality is they did not ride really anywhere at all. They did most of their travel by foot. Well, moving on from there, here you can see a sunken ship. This is looking out from Santiago Harbor, looking outward. And you can see a Spanish cruiser in the background, the Moro Castle, that I think your professor referred to the other day. Moving on from there, the machine gun, an example of the changing technology that affects everything here. The original caption for this picture read as follows. Think of the changes in warfare here. The operator has simply to grasp the handles, keep his fingers upon the trigger, and swing the gun to and fro as a fireman handles the nozzle. He is able to pour upon the enemy a literal stream of bullets. What do I say to that? Well, two words. More than that, actually. Don't blink! Don't even blink. Blink and you're dead. Don't turn your back. Don't look away. And don't blink. Well, technology is about more than just weapons. Here you can see in the Philippines that bicycles have replaced horses. This is the Spanish bicycle troops of the Manila Garrison, a very highly mobile infantry in its day. Allons-y. Here we have Jose Marti, one of the founding fathers of an independent Cuba. In terms of background, Marti is born in Havana in 1893. He was not only a revolutionary, but also a writer, a poet, and a painter. He died on May 19th, 1895, while fighting Spanish troops in the Battle of Dos Rios. Many have argued that he died in a kind of suicide run, making a suicide run against the Spanish on account of his attempts to prove his bravery, his masculinity. It's said that others, including Marcejo, argue that this man, Marti, had spurned combat. Marti decides then he will die fighting. As he wrote shortly before his death, "May they not bury me in darkness to die like a traitor. I am God, and as a good man, I will die facing the sun." Jose Marti. Well, here you have Antonio Maceo that I referred to before. I should note that he is sometimes called the Bronze Titan because of the many bullets he received and survived, for the most part, at least until the very end. It was the 26th, really the 27th bullet that killed him. Today he's considered one of the outstanding guerrilla leaders in 19th century Latin America. And here we have not Antonio Maceo, but rather the man that he fought beside and with. Who is this here? Well, I'm looking in my notes. I forget things. You would too if you were 900 plus years old. Here we have the General Massimo Gomez. In terms of background, he was originally Spanish by birth. That is to say, born a Spanish citizen, but in what is today the Dominican Republic. He serves for a lengthy period of time in the Spanish military, but eventually settles in Cuba, and with his military scheming and prowess, he leads the fight for independence. He was very, very close, I should note, to his troops, but especially to his second-in-command, Antonio Maceo, that I showed you before. Gomez's son actually dies trying to retrieve Maceo's body after the 26th, the 27th bullet had hit. Well, here you can see each one of these men is today conceived of as a founding father. They've made their on the currency. Moving on from there, just some scenes that show you Havana and other places in Cuba during this period of time. Another image here, another image here, and yet another street scene that, among other things, speaks to the poverty of this day. Well, moving on from there, you can see the Havana of our day and time, and it's the same kinds of buildings. Many of these buildings date to the early 20th century. Another image here, and finally an image of Havana Bay, the Pearl of the Caribbean, as it is called. Well, here you can see the Cuban flag being hoisted for the first time on May the 20th, 1902. This is the day when Cuba had not only succeeded in securing its independence from Spain, it had done that 4 years before with the defeat of Spain to the United States, but now it secures its independence from the United States. In this regard, it bears noting that the United States would go on to occupy Cuba for a period of time, and even here, when the flag is being raised after what was called the Platt Amendment of 1901, the reality is Cuba's independence is very much always in question. The Platt Amendment of 1901, passed by the U.S. Congress, ceded lots of things to the United States in return for giving Cuba its independence. What did it cede? Well, first off, the rights to Guantanamo Bay, where a U.S. naval base would be built. And if you look at your map here, you can see Guantanamo Bay here. This dates to the Spanish-American War. Additionally, the treaty stipulated that Cuba would not transfer Cuban land to any power other than the U.S. It mandated that Cuba would not contract any foreign debt without guarantees that the interest could be served from ordinary revenues. It ensured U.S. intervention in Cuban affairs when the United States deemed it necessary. It prohibited Cuba from negotiating treaties with any other country besides the United States and provided for a formal treaty detailing all of the foregoing provisions. Well, 1934, all of these provisions will be done away with one exception, Guantanamo Bay. And here you can see an image of Guantanamo Bay with the Pacific and the Atlantic fleets gathered together there in 1910. And here, of course, you can see Guantanamo Naval Base today. Another image, an image not from the air, but from the ground. Here you can see, looking out, the division between Cuba and Guantanamo. And looking closer, what does it say? What does it say? The Republic of Cuba, the free territory of America. Obviously, a number of Cubans, thousands and thousands, would have some issues with this, even if this is what the Castro brothers say is true. Well, let me go from there to some final thoughts in terms of the significance of all of this, and also an attempt to answer one final question.
Well, the question becomes now, what are we to make of all of this? And the answer is all sorts of things. The story of the Spanish-American War, on the one hand, is the story of the end of the Spanish seaborne empire. Independence comes not only to Cuba, but to Puerto Rico, to the Philippines as well. It is the story of an ending of an empire that you have studied over the course of 300-400 years. Beyond the story of an end, it is also the story of a beginning. The beginning of the rise of another great imperial power, a potency A power that will become more and more important in the decades and the century that follow. The United States of America. In this respect, it seems fitting to take to you the words, to bring to you the words of a man who governed a country that lay right next to the United States. And that is Porfirio Diaz, the president of Mexico, during the same period of time in which the Spanish-American War occurred. The president of an independent Mexico, Porfirio Diaz, during this very period of time is purported to have said, "Poor Mexico, so far from heaven, so near the United States." Well, words that are imbued with meaning, as we shall see during the second half of the semester. Well, that all being said, I've taken you today, I hope, on a journey that you enjoyed. A journey, really, through time, through space. But wait. I promised to take you upon a literal journey. A journey that would have the answer to many of your questions. Among others, how was it that the United States of America could so easily, so handily defeat Spain in the War of 1898? The answer to that question can be found in a backyard. Not my backyard, if you will, but yours. To take you there, however, I need the keys. Let me see. Not here. There's my screwdriver again. I wonder what that does. Very good. Lovely screwdriver, but it won't pilot the TARDIS. Let me see. If you have a mystery, who do you go to have it solved? Well, Agatha. Agatha Christie, of course. Let me see. Tolkien here, P.G. Woodhouse there. More Tolkien, more P.G. Woodhouse. Christie. Agatha Christie! Here she is, right here. Look at that. Poirot, Agatha Christie. And here are my keys. The keys to my TARDIS. Let me take you there.
Oh, yes. Well, here we are. I told you the answers to all of the questions were in the backyard. Well, not in my backyard, per se, but rather the TARDIS will take us there. Here I have my Type 4D TARDIS Sonic. Believe you me, it's bigger on the inside than it is on the out. And here is the key. All right, let us begin. The end of our journey will give us the answers to everything you've ever wanted to know. Always wear your scope. We're traveling through the time vortex. Well, I've fitted the randomizer to the TARDIS console. We are ready to go. The randomizer, you may have heard of it. It's fitted to the console and operates under a very complex principle called potluck. Let's see what it takes.
Hello, Dolly. Yes, hello, Dolly. It's so nice. Sometimes there are these stops when you're in the time vortex. You never know what you're going to encounter. But we're getting close. We're getting close. Hello, Dolly. Yes, hello, Dolly. Well, we're getting very close. Oh, it's so exciting. It's so very exciting. Do you know, if the square of our hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the square of the other two sides, then why is a mouse when it spins? Never could answer that one. Well, we're getting close, you can see, we're getting very close. I promised you the answer to all of the questions was in the backyard. Well, not the backyard exactly, rather the front yard. The front yard of the University of Kentucky. And I will take you there in just one moment after I can find parking. And here we are. Always fun to bring the TARDIS to an end. In terms of these little escapades. It's a good vehicle.
All right, well, as I said, The answers to all of the questions can be found here in front of the University of Kentucky. Now, what are the main questions? How was it that the United States was able to defeat Spain in a matter really of weeks? And the answer to that question lies before you. Come with me, and I will show you. To many of you, you may think this is just an odd thing up in front of the main building, but it's much more than that. It's the answer to the Spanish-American War. Come and take a look with me. What is it that you're looking at? Well, if we look here, it looks like a piece of artillery. Come along, come along. It looks like just a normal piece of artillery. But if you look up top, you can find an interesting answer. Come along, come along. Up here, you will see some words written. Bring it along here. You see, Barcelona, the 29th of October of 1795. Barcelona, the 29th of October, 1795, was when this piece of artillery was made. It was part, really, of the Bourbon reforms in which Spain was intent on holding on to its empire by the end of the 18th century. Well, 100 years later, more than 100 years later, in 1898, this baby here, if you'll excuse the expression, was being used to fight against the United States. How is it that the United States beat Spain in the Spanish-American War? Spain was fighting with artillery that was more than 100 years old. How did this piece of artillery come to campus? It is a war trophy from the Spanish-American War, captured by a regiment from Kentucky that was fighting in Cuba in 1898. Take a look at it, it's lovely. You can see it here. Let's get it on film. Take a look here. Barcelona, the 29th of October, 1795. And up top here, you can see the lovely Spanish emblem. And looking straight out from here, you can see the target, the College of Education. And on that happy note, I bid you all farewell and good luck. Bye-bye.